So let me ask you, is it louder? Sorry. As an actress, is there any difference in the way you prepare to make a television movie, a television show, a motion picture?
Well, when I was doing television, that was in the 50s in New York, in the late 40s, and it was live. And that is an incredible experience because it's like doing a play, because nothing, you can't go back, that is live. What you're doing, what you're saying, you can't go back and say, let's do that again. So I had some terrible stories to tell, but I don't have the time because you don't have it down there. Should I tell one?
Yes.
Right, I'm gonna tell one. Did any of you ever listen to the radio One Man's Family? Well, there was a series. Until you saw it, you want to stand up and talk about it, how good I was? No, it was One Man's Family, and it was live. And it was about a family who always had problems. But I played Claudia. And one day, I was on the set, and I was in a pool with a bathing suit, talking to my father-in-law. And there was a noise, and I didn't know what it was. You learn that if there's any noise in the studio, just ignore it. Continue what you are doing. So I didn't look to see what was wrong. But finally, I thought, something is wrong. And I looked over, and the first man there was going like this, lit like this. And I was in a pool in a bathing suit, and I realized that, well, was being shown from coast to coast. So what I did is, I didn't panic, I just went down in the water like this. Well, that's scary anyway. It makes you stronger though, because terrible things happen in live television, as things happen in life. And you can't go back, and there's the screen, and can I tell one more?
Sure.
Okay, so another one, which was on One Man's Family again. Oh, that's right. I was on an airplane with my father, I think it was, on an airplane. And we were having a scene. Some of you saw this. We were having a scene on the airplane. I was next to the window. And the actor, I finished what I had to say to him. It was about marrying and the wedding and all of that. And so I was sitting. He started to talk, and then in the middle of the scene, he looked at me, the camera's rolling, and he said, Jesus Christ, I've blown the scene. I said, Father Roberts, I think I'll take a nap. They went to, yes, a soap commercial. And then we had to finish, and I kept talking to my actor friend. I said, nobody knows. Nobody. You know, you have to get on track, and this is what you're supposed to say. And I got him on track. And he finished. It was okay. And the show was over, and Eddie Kahn, the director, started to come over. And I just couldn't get out of my seat because the trauma hit me. And I asked for a shot of whiskey. I've never had whiskey. I never had it then because I didn't touch it. I just felt that was the thing to say. Not to this day, I don't drink whiskey. But I thought it was a smart thing to say. And it was a horrible experience. but that was live television, and it strengthened you, made you strong, and that's why I'm still strong.
There you go. That's a good reason. But how did you get off with the part in this stuff?
My dear husband and I, director, and we were working in a play in, I think it was Pocono, somewhere in the East, and I just had the Oscar baby. I did not call him Oscar, believe me. Call him Daryl. But that same little baby that right up, see the Oscar. I had that baby, and I had my husband, and these two gentlemen from Hollywood heard that I was there, and they liked Waterfront, and they thought it'd be fun for me to do a comedy following Waterfront. So I went off and read the script when my husband entertained them, because they had flown in all the way from here to New York. And I finished, and I said, well, that could be fun. First of all, I had seen Bob Hope, I think, in every movie. My folks love movies, and we all, with the family, went to see Bob Hope. So I said yes, like that. And it's not the greatest movie in the world, but it's fun. I love making it, and to go from the Actors Studio with Lee Strasberg to Hollywood to make this crazy film was quite a leap.
When you read a script, what do you look for?
Well, it's a very personal reaction you have. You look for your character, how it's written, if it's an honest character that you could relate to or not relate to, but interesting. And the script, generally, is it exciting or how it's supposed to be? It's the writing of the story and the characters that make a fine script. But it's always, I have a terrible story though. North by Northwest, I just had another baby, and I was reading the script in bed, and I read it, and I gave it to my husband to read. Being a director, he was very helpful, because I said, honey, I don't want to do this. I come in page 40. He said, honey, just let me read this.
No.
It's with Hot Hitchcock. And he read it, and then he knocked on the door and said, I said, come here, honey, do this. Just do North by Northwest. It's harder than I guess.
Did he often read your scripts?
Yes, and I would read his scripts too. He was, That's what you do in a happy marriage.
So since you were working mostly in New York before you made this film, how was it making the picture in Hollywood? Was it a different experience than working on the East Coast?
Oh, well, on the waterfront was one place, Hoboken. But I love that, because that's where we were, in Hoboken. And all the people just were so happy when we arrived. And by the sixth week, they were ready for us to go, because they had those lights outside all night. We were filming a lot at night, and but it was a real, that house that I lived in the movie, that belonged to a newlywed couple. And after about the third week, I thought, I'm so sad that I'm doing this in their apartment. And they should be here, and they should be starting their life together. Well, I got over that. But my first scene is on the rooftop, where I give my brother's coat to Marlon Brando. And that was the first scene in a movie I ever made. And my dear, beautiful director, Kazan, was telling me, as I stood there before we started, it was dark. Marlon was over there. And he said, now, Avery, in this scene, you are really terrified. And an animal could come any minute. His whisper could come any minute. And you just are so, so terrified. And that's how I want you to be. And you go over to give your coat to this young man. Because you don't know. You've never had an experience with a man before, a young man. And he's telling me all this. And I'm thinking, you don't have to say a word. I am so nervous. And I had seen him, and I saw him since. But that was the first scene, and after that, Kazan was just incredible to work with and work for, and Marlon Brando was dear, dear. My feeling is that Marlon was one of the finest actors we ever had, and I think, I don't know, I didn't keep up with him, but I have a feeling he might have lost his love of acting, and I guess when that happens, you just stop, because he lived on a mountain, he became very isolated, and I just think he is, I have to tell a story why I think he is, from my experience. In Making on the Waterfront, his aunt would be directing one scene, but you were always working the next scene that was supposed to come up. So when he was lighting that scene, he would come and watch you wherever you were working. Because you're up your next stop, the scene. And it was a scene with Mike Glove, the gloves. Mm-hmm. And the first time that I'm talking to this young man, I'm a very sheltered young woman. I haven't had the experience of knowing a man, the opposite sex. In the scene, I have gloves on and I take them off, and one dropped. And I started to get my glove, but Marlon, the actor in character, put that on his hand in a very sensuous way. And it worked for the scene because I had to stay and talk with him to get my glove. He didn't give it back. Well, Gatch came to see our scene, to see what we had done. He said, exactly the way you rehearsed it, the two of you, that's what I want to film. And I'm only telling you that because there have been about 10 renditions about that. Mm-hmm. Damn clock. And what happened to it, and why it happened. Did you know that story?
I think you told me. Oh. But thank you.
The only person in the whole world asked. The only reason I tell you is because very often it's been written about, and it's that it was direct. I mean, that it was written that way, but it wasn't written that way. But it shows how incredible actor that Marlon was. Mm. I'm convinced that any other actor would pick it up and stop rehearsing it. And Kazan saw what the dropping of the glove did. And said, that's what we do. I'm going on and on because people have a completely wrong idea. And if you ever hear anybody start telling you the other way, you say, you know, you know.
You got it right here. So, I want to ask you, this is the first color film you've made. And,
well, it's only the second movie.
Touche. And your clothes really told a great part of who your character is.
Exactly. Edith Head was such a lovely lady. I mean, she was so talented, but she's just an incredible person. And I had the first meeting with the producers, who also directed, and with Edith, we had the meeting, and it was kind of over my head. It was my second film, and I had never been in the kind of meeting that was going on. And the producers, directors, they left, and it was too much for me to hear all of this because I didn't understand a lot of it, the making this kind of movie. And after they left, Edith Head said, Eva Marie. So I followed her and went into her office, and she said, now you and I are going to do this. We're going to decide the costumes and the clothes and, you know, all of that. And I thought, well, isn't that nice? And she said, I could tell from the way you sat in the meeting that you like full skirts. Well, I did, but I also like striped skirts. But so we did it together. I mean, not together. She, of course, designed it. After that, I could always go to her if I felt something about the costume was not right, but it was all right because she had designed it and she supervised the making of it. She became kind of a friend after that. She was, she's everything you thought she was.
What effect do you think the wardrobe can have on you as an actress and the character you're playing?
Well, that's interesting. In Waterfront, I had one navy blue dress, one navy blue coat. And that was a long, long time
ago. One pair of gloves.
They weren't navy. No. But as a result of that, to this day, I have never owned a piece of navy clothing. I mean, I overdosed on navy.
That's funny.
But that was Edie on the Waterfront. And I felt, as I look back, that maybe Hitchcock saw me in that certain feeling. I have to sing it because I sing it. I never meant to know it. You'll hear it, see. And I had such fun making this movie. But I think Hitch might have seen me in this movie because we are some beautiful.
Now, up to this point in your career, this is one of the most physically demanding parts you have.
Demanding part in a movie?
Yeah.
I don't
think
they
need
one.
Well, and a television show.
51st is really hard.
Okay. Yeah, I guess. Well, no, I'm trying to play straight man.
You play straight man.
But tell us about the sequence when you got to dance with Bob Hope.
Oh, that's a feeling. Yes, it is in a costume, and he has the same costume, like it on. And we're dancing, and I used to play the violin, but I'm playing this. And just the idea of, you know, being fun. And one day, however, wasn't such fun. I was going across the table, because we were dancing on a table, and someone had polished it, and they weren't supposed to, and I'm dancing along, and whoosh. It was tragic. I fell off the table. And landed on the floor. And I just remember saying, no folios. Crazy. That was only my second movie. Who did I think I was?
There you go. Now, other than your performance in the film, I thought one of the other really terrific performances was the performance of the television director in the movie. Do you know what ever happened to him?
That was my dear husband. small little part.
Eva Marie Saint, Larry Merritt, thank you, Larry. Eva, I'm asking the same way for the night.